Thank you, thank you. The next speaker is Sri Sukhendu Sekhar Rai.
Thank you, sir. So far this bill is concerned, it was introduced in Rajya Sabha on 19th of August 2013 and we are discussing on 19th of July 2018. So almost 5 years have elapsed. The previous government introduced this bill in a situation when the entire country, almost the entire country, was engulfed with some anarchical situation. So many people said that under duress, the previous government introduced the bill in this house. But rightly, the bill was forwarded to the standing committee. Standing committee submitted its report when the new government took over. Thereafter, the recommendations of Law Commission was sought for, and after that, this bill was again sent to Select Committee. So with this background, I am happy that at least this bill has got the scrutiny of both Standing Committee and Select Committee, which is the normal procedure or practice of Indian Parliament, and all important bills should be scrutinized like this bill by either the Standing Committee or the Select Committee or the both. Now, sir, referring to the bill, because I am not in a mood to go for a public speech, I am concentrating on this bill only. Clause 2, the word gratification has not been defined. The gratification has not also been defined in the Parent Act of 1988. Here it says in the explanation to clause 2D that for the purposes of this clause, the word gratification is not limited to pecuniary gratifications or to gratification estimable in money. That is there in the parent law also. If it is not limited to pecuniary gratification or gratifications estimable in money, then what are the other elements of gratification? That should be spelled out. Otherwise, in absence of proper definition, the authorities concerned may misuse this this provision of the law. This is my first point. Sir, the second point that I would like to refer, in clause 7C, it is said that any public servant who perform improperly or dishonestly a public duty in anticipation of or in consequence of accepting an undue advantage from any person shall be punishable, which shall not be less than 3 years, but which may extend to 7 years and also liable to fine. So minimum 3 years, maximum 7 years, and if necessary, both fine also. It is in the case of a bribe taker that is defined, that has been provided for in clause 7C. But if you look at clause 8 1II, that in what will be the punishment in case of bribe receiver, here it is said that any person who gives or promises to give the bribe giver, I'm sorry, any person who gives or promises to give an undue advantage to another person shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 7 years, or fine or both. Here that minimum term, 3 years, is not absent. So the bribe giver, in his case, the punishment is up to 7 years. In case of bribe taker, the minimum period of punishment is 3 years. Here, what the DOPT said. DOPT said before the minister is here, the DOPT said before the committee, select committee, it said that both the bribe giver and bribe receiver are equal partners in the offense of corruption. This is the version of DOPT before the Select Committee of Parliament. Therefore, if the bribe giver and the bribe receiver are equal partner of the offence, then there should not be any discrimination between the quantum of between the two on the quantum of punishment. Therefore, my submission through you to the government, sir, that this point should be taken care of and there should not be any discrimination. The same punishment which has been proposed for the bribe giver, the bribe receiver should also get the same quantum of punishment. That is my suggestion. Then, sir, the next point is, sir, regarding the commercial organization. Much has been talked about. We dealt with so many distinguished colleagues. My distinguished colleagues were there in the committee. They suggested so many things, and this was incorporated after thorough deliberations that commercial organizations should also have the vicarious liability so far the offense is committed. Now, sir, here also in clause 10, sub clause 1, where an offense under section 9 is committed by a commercial organization and such offense is proved in the court to have been committed with the consent or connivance of any director, manager, secretary, etc., 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 he shall be liable to be prosecuted against and shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term of which shall not be less than 3 years, but which may extend to 7 years and also liable to fine. So here also this quantum of punishment, minimum 3 years, maximum 7 years, and fine also if necessary. So I am mentioning all these things because there are changes, there are differences between the bribe receiver and the bribe giver. Now, sir, another point, very interesting point, it's an interesting point of law rather, that under clause 18A, sub clause 1 and 2, this bill has taken shelter of Criminal Law Amendment Ordinance 1944 Criminal Law Ordinance, although it is still subsisting in view of the Indian, the provisions of the Constitution, I will refer to, in view of the Article 372(1) and Article 295 of the Constitution, the Indian Independence Act of 1947, and such ordinances which were passed by the British government during emergency period in 1944, that is still subsisting, and we have taken refuge to that provisions of ordinance, which according to me is not fair. Is not fair. And what CBI said before the committee in regard to this, CBI said, one second, sir. I am coming to that portion of what CBI said. I quote, sir, from the report of the Standing Committee placed before this House. With respect to attachment of property, because their ordinance has been referred to in regard to attachment of property. So CBI says, and I quote, with respect to attachment of property, the director submitted that the Law Commission in its 249th report had recommended to repeal Criminal Law Amendment Ordinance 1944 being obsolete. He was of the view that the provision of Odisha Special Courts Act 2006 and Bihar Special Courts Act 2009 are better suited for the purpose of attachment and forfeiture of property which has gained currency in USA, UK, Australia, Canada, and other European countries. So this was the recommendation of Law Commission, which was cited by CBI before the Select Committee, which has not been adhered to by the government for reasons better known to them. I am of the view that the government should take note of seriously the suggestions made by CBI that the 1944 Criminal Law Ordinance, which has become almost obsolete, that should not be taken into consideration. Rather, the Bihar Act and the Odisha Act should be adhered to. Now, sir, before Even CVC also came before us, before the Select Committee. And there we raised so many questions, and there is no answer so far in this bill. For example, here it has been stated in this bill that the trial should be completed initially within 2 hours, if it, 2 years. If it is not possible, then it can be extended up to four years.
Every 6 months
it should be extended. That has been given suggested in this bill. But if the question is, if within 4 years the trial is not completed, then what will be the consequences? Nothing has been said in this bill. It is not that, it is in the hands of the special court. Sir, I'm sorry, kindly give me some time. It's a very important bill, sir. I'm not opposing the bill. I'm trying to improve the bill with my submissions. So kindly give me 2-3 minutes extra, sir. Sir, I'm not opposing. Sir, now, the question is this. Should willful defaults, as rightly pointed out by Sri Anand Sharmaji and other members, should willful defaults in cases of loans taken from public sector banks be included as offences covered under Prevention of Corruption Act 1988, as the public money has become NPA by way of bank fraud? There is a monumental corruption in the PSU banks, and we have seen and witnessed in the recent years what has happened. They are taking money, thousands of crores of rupees, and running away from the country, taking shelter in such countries with whom we do not have any extradition treaty, and they cannot be deported from that country to India. So it's a very serious situation, sir. Only poor lenders who have taken 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs of rupees for starting a small-scale industry or a small business, they are being chased like anything. And those people who have plundered to the tune of thousands of crores of rupees, they are roaming around, and no action can be initiated against them. Entire government, entire opposition, entire parliament, entire judicial system is looking helpless. This situation is not at all warranted. And therefore, those who have taken money from the bank and willful defaulters, in spite of the ability to repay, they are not repaying. They must be covered under the Prevention of Corruption Act. This is my demand before this government.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
With these words, I conclude. Thank you so much.
Sri Prasanna Acharya.